And welcome to the Lync 2013 Ignite Lync Updates and Programs Lync Devices Strategy Course. I'm Brian Ricks.
And I'm Aaron Steele.
And Aaron, would you mind introducing yourself?
I can do that for you, Brian. I'm a senior consultant with Microsoft in our services arm. I've been with Microsoft for about 3 years now, focused mostly on Lync and specifically on enterprise voice when we talk about Lync. I've been doing computers and general Microsoft technologies for about the past 18 years. I live in Chicago with my wife and two wonderful kids.
Thank you. And I am Brian Ricks. I am the owner of Brightcomp Computers. We deal with unified communications architecting as well as infrastructure, Microsoft and others. I've been an MVP for the Lync product since 2006 when it was OCS. I've been using the Lync product concept since the LCS 2003 days. I am a Microsoft Certified Solutions Master's in Communications and have been doing this for 20 years more or less. Independent, however, with my own company since 2009. Okay, for this particular presentation, we are going to be looking at the target audience, that would be you, as being someone that has rolled out, deployed, understands, designed, migrated to Lync 2013. So this isn't a what's and how to on Lync 2013. Instead, this is for individuals that are looking to understand the new capabilities and the features of Lync 2013 post-RTM.
Especially as it relates to the devices.
Yeah, in this course, we're talking about devices. If you would like to look at some other resources to get further information on Lync 2013 in general, there is the 2336 and 2337 courses that are offered by Microsoft that are designed to
Microsoft trainers.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And they lead you to the certifications of 7336 and 7337. In addition, those two exams are required to work towards your Microsoft MCSE communications, which includes those two exams and some Windows exams as well. And then, of course, if you'd like, you can go to a certified training partner, CPLS, and take the courses there. And if you're looking for a course, there's a link at the bottom for class locator to find the course nearest you. So, Lync device strategies. We're going to talk about what is a device. So a lot of times the question comes, what is a device? We're going to talk about that. There's two types of Lync devices, optimized versus compatible. Who has enabled what in the back end from a device's perspective, and then examples of issues and previous support problems that we've had with some devices. We'll talk about that briefly as well. So what is a device? What constitutes a physical device? Well, that can be...
What is a device, Brian?
From a Lync perspective, that can be a phone, that could be a new conference room, that could be a PC, that could be a mobile phone, that could be a slate, that could be a load balancer that's part of a device. All these different things that come into the play, but in this particular instance, we're going to look specifically at the phones themselves. Those would be Aries phones, and the concept of the devices made specifically for Lync that have Lync Phone Edition on them, and as well as the 3-pip devices. Those are the devices that are provided by the partners that are created to be compatible and interopt with Lync. So going further into that, you're looking at optimized versus compatible. At a high level, the Aries phones are the optimized. They are devices that are running Lync Phone Edition, meaning they're running a version of Microsoft Lync on the physical phone. They're managed by Lync system. It's a core deployment system. There's three partners. There's seven different phones out there that exist. And they really are tied into a design and a requirements that are set forth by Microsoft on how to create it. There's a little flexibility on the kind of looks and feel, but not really. It requires them to have a certain screen size, a certain resolution, buttons, all of that's kind of laid out.
And it's really hard to get those things changed.
Because it's a change to all manufacturers. So if you were to say, I was going with an Astra phone, but that means that if Astra makes the change, because Microsoft decides that that's the way they're going to do, they're going to have to force those changes on to Polycom, onto HP, and all those things are going to have to flow just the same. And so that becomes a bigger challenge. Now, when we look at the 3-pip, the compatible devices, these are partner-based solutions. That means Microsoft has guidelines of how these things are going to need to interoperate. There are protocols and how they work, how they don't work. They have to be able to communicate natively with Lync, with Active Directory logins, things of that nature. Some of them will have more features than others. Some will look completely different. It's all up to the partner to decide how they should best deliver a device based off of what they deem a requirement from the market. So what do they think they can sell and what are people looking for? So the 3PIP, the third party interrupt program, it's just an internal term that's been kind of stuck and is around forever, but you may hear 3PIP, you may hear compatible, they're the same thing. Okay. So
it's good to know what I like to remember about those optimized versus compatible is optimized, they're running the Microsoft code and they don't require any what we might term interoperability testing, that whereas the 3PIP products are running non-Microsoft code and require going through the UCO IP and qualification and sort of proving out
that they work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So optimized versus compatible. So there's various kinds of phones, and you'll notice in the optimized, it's a far fewer phones, and there are phones that exist, but perhaps not to the level or degree that of feature sets that you're looking for, and then we can look at the compatible. So there is a conference phone solution, the Polycom CX3000, that exists today. In the common area phones, you go through the Astra, the HP, and the Polycom solutions, and then in the knowledge worker, you get onto the further side. So common area, fewer features, typically a single network port on it, typically at a lower speed, maybe not a speakerphone on it,
right.
Doesn't have a USB port, which is the big one, which means if you're a knowledge worker and you want to tether your device and you want to log into the device with your computer, the knowledge worker phone is what you're looking for. Moving beyond that, we get to the compatible, where now all of a sudden there's an array of things that we can look at. So the knowledge worker phones, and this is just a small fraction of what is in the compatible market, but you'll notice there's different looks, feels, colors. Some are touchscreen, some are not touchscreen. Some have a bunch of buttons, multi-line capabilities by registering multiple user accounts. So not that Lync has become a multi-line solution, it's simply the phone is registered to more than one physical login device. Common area phones that can exist and that are at the lower scale market and an extreme lower cost because the SIP phone is just a SIP phone that can talk to Lync on a very basic level. It can make a phone call, can do no other interaction, no calendaring, no real gal lookup like you would expect from an EWS integration mm-hmm. perspective. But their cost point and is much lower and maybe a valid common area phone, especially in ones in warehouses and things getting replaced. Paging devices exist that don't even conceptually exist in the optimized world, can exist and do exist in the compatible area so that it can be assigned a Lync account and it can be called from a Lync phone, and then it produces a paging out, right?
Opens up an audio channel. There's some pretty,
there's
pretty
a lot
powerful
of different
capabilities
yeah.
there.
Sidecars that exist, wireless phones for those that are back to wanting to be able to move around and don't want to use a headset, prefer the wireless phone. All of these things are where we get the various compatible phones. So in order to be compatible, there are basically two categories we have. There's the core functionality in order to be able to work with Lync, and then there's extended capabilities that allow you to get better audio quality and feature sets that exist on the phones. So every phone that's listed as a qualified phone will have at minimum the core components, and that would be the ability to log into Lync, to understand NAT traversal, so ICE and everything works as you would expect. Basic call controls, can I dial a number? Can I hang up the phone? Can I answer a call? You know, things that you would expect on a phone.
Volume, mute.
Various basic things. And there is no other gateway that it has to register to that it can log in directly to the Lync system. So if it can do that, and it's gone through the certification process, then it's a compatible phone at the core level. There's extended features that are up to the partners if they want to extend beyond that, which would include stuff like, instead of pairing over USB, pairing over Ethernet. The capabilities to do wideband and use the RT audio wideband acoustics so things sound better and your experience is better from a quality perspective. Exchange calendar integration has come to the Polycom VVX phone, VXX.
VVX,
yeah.
VVX 500 and 600s, yep.
Recently, and allows you to get some of the functionality that you have in the optimized. Not exactly the same, but it's some functionality and capabilities that exist. And really, mm-hmm. it's about having a choice now and investing in the phone that you think is what you need from a feature set perspective. So if a sidecar is what's important and the attendant console is not for you, there are solutions out there for you. If it's something else that you want, well, then great. So not in scope, things that, that vendors can add that don't really add to whether it's compatible or not are things like, can we add custom ringtones? Do we have the ability to be managed by their special web GUI?
Or web browsing.
Web browsing out of the phone.
From the phone.
In fact, on the VVXs, they have the capability to web browse. I'm not 100% sure where that's positioned at, but I have used it to pull down graphics from a website to set the wallpaper on the phone, which that's a cool thing, right? So now you can brand your phones and give it, instead of being a generic gray background or circular swirly things, all of a sudden it's your logo that's the background. So that kind of stuff is where it's up to the partner to decide what kind of, what do they want to extend that is outside the box of what we consider Lync.
Right. And in fact, we don't test any of those things that those vendors implement for that space. So if it's not in core or extended and they just decide to add it on, we don't really test it either.
So compatible programs. The compatibility testing in general is an interesting engagement process. And I've only been involved personally with it from an ITSP perspective, given a trunk certified or a program certified for a vendor. But it is extremely a closed engagement in that you get direct access and partners and relationships with Microsoft to go through the process. Information and specs and data is provided, and then specific testing is done down in Texas to make sure that you can actually do exactly what's in this list, and it's run through a long process of tests back and forth, and it's not a free process for the vendor, so they have to actually pay for all of this testing and process and to get into it. See, there's over 400 to 500 qualification tests for the device side for an interop perspective. So from how things run and call scenarios and quality tests and packet loss, all of the things that would qualify you to be a compatible phone have to be certified through this testing center. And it's, again, up to the vendor to be certified. So there's an investment on the vendor side, there's an investment on Microsoft side, and the relationship works to create these compatible devices. The audio codes for 420 HD IP phones were just certified September 19th, and additional ones are coming out. So we have, and audio codes, I know it has these bundles of things, is now that they have this compatibility and they already have gateways that are compatible, now they're giving away phones, and if you buy certain gateways with X amount of seats, I mean, so it allows the vendors to leverage what they know and their capabilities to give you as the consumer a better end user experience and not be within such a confined box of requirements, but they can think outside and design things that perhaps you were looking for and work better with their equipment.
Mm-hmm.
So what does this mean to you from an end user? Well, that means that instead of having really seven devices, a conference and then either common area, three common and three, really two phones, they're all the same phone in reality, right? So you have three things, a conference, a common, and the power worker's phone, knowledge worker. You have now the ability to say, okay, that's all great and fine, and while I see some benefits to these phones and there's some ease of training and usage that may be here, maybe I want to look at these other options. So it's options. It's all about where the ecosystem is not tied down to a specific set of vendors following a specific set of rules. Instead, it's opened up to whomever wants to play in this market space, who can create a device and be qualified by Microsoft, and their device is now deemed a Lync-compatible phone. It could mean all kinds of future opportunities from the mobile perspective, so making devices which do exist to traverse the edge scenarios more efficiently and be able to log in as an external device versus having certificate issues with your internal certs expiring every so often on your phones. Those kind of things go away. And maybe it means similar to where things are going from a bring your own mobile device to work concept, from getting into linking it to your exchange. If you want to have a smartphone, a lot of companies are saying, sure, buy your own. We support X, Y, and Z's manufacturers. Go ahead and get it. It's up to you. Same concept could apply to headsets. Hey, you don't like the headsets we've got? As long as it's a Lync-compatible headset, feel free to go and purchase your own headset at your cost. That opens up that opportunity. And in general, when people are worried about where the phone market's going, keep in mind that the Lync product was designed as a soft phone first with the desk phone second. So the design was never to have a phone on everybody's desk. The design was conceptually that you would want to get rid of your desk phone, free up your desk space, and have all the rich functionality that the Lync client is dynamically changing in every release. Mm-hmm. But there still is understanding that 20% or so of users are going to need an IP phone for one reason or another. Valid reasons exist. There are a lot of them. One of them could very well be the need for common area phones. You're not going to put a PC up there with a headset for people to come and pick up. Not only is that not nice, but it's not practical. So you're going to have common area phones. You may have users that just need to have a backup telephone in case their headset dies because it's a high demand call center of some sort.
Yep.
Or
there's a bunch of scenarios here where exist. And it is something that I've seen at a number of customers is that 20% benchmark is pretty straightforward and pretty well proven out.
Yeah, and it isn't necessarily in today's 20% a requirement of 20%. It could very well be that it's just the way that the people are used to using phones and push mm-hmm. back to adoption. So if you can't get some people to adopt for whatever reason, it is possible to say, okay, there are devices. And that's what we have for you today. So reports are out. There's a Gartner report link in here that shows you that should we choose one, should we choose the other. There are plenty of reasons to use a headset. Either you're a believer or you're not. It's just one of those things. Once you get there, you can't live without.
I don't know. Does it mess up your hair?
It does not. And in fact, the only complaint I would have would be as a glass wearer. I wear contacts, obviously. But as wearing glasses, those that go over the ear, you can get some contention and pressure from glasses. So perhaps ones that are in the ear, behind the ear, or over the ear are a solution. I mean, again, it's back to there's all kinds of headsets out there and figuring out which one works. But thank you for my concern on my hair because that does matter. It does. I'm sorry. So the device choice matters, and making sure that it is adopted by the end user is just as important as the quality of the device. Because if the user doesn't work for the user for whatever reason, then it's not going to matter if it's a great technology. So from an IP phone infrastructure, we still have the requirements of getting the devices on the network. You have the option of doing VLANs and LLDP MED in order to specify a specific VLAN to get them off, and it may be part of your QoS strategy, even tagging strategy as it may be. But it's also important from a E911 perspective for those devices. We need to know where they're at, and there's no way to know where they're at if they're just generically on the network. PoE, although not required, is one of those things that makes your rollout of physical IP phones much easier. Hmm. It gives you the capability to not have to have another network drop if you do not wish, to piggyback your computer off of these devices, and to power the phone without a drop, which is especially important for common area locations, mounting on walls, things of that nature.
Completely agreed, but I would make sure to order at least some adapters to inject power in case PoE doesn't reach every location. It's good as you're planning your rollout of these devices to understand that some of the locations you might put them in don't have power over Ethernet to them, and a good sort of backup is to be able to plug those into the wall and still get them turned on and working without the PoE.
Yeah, and not only injectors, because the injectors fixes the issue where you'd want PoE there. If you don't care about a power plug source, you can order power bricks for these devices as well. So that's an option. And a great point. Keep in mind that if you're not fully PoE or PoE doesn't reach everywhere you think you want it to reach, it's very capable to do other power source options. And common area devices, they work great. They do exactly what they're designed to do. They have limited functionality, which is what they're designed to do because they're a common area phone. Don't make the mistake of thinking you're saving money by buying a bunch of Polycom CX500s and trying to deploy those as your regular phones. That is not what they're designed for. CX600s, in this case, is what would be the regular user phone, the 500s for those common areas. And you'll be sorely disappointed. And again, the end user gets a bad experience, so it's
if
not
you
something
can't,
you want.
I can't turn on my speakerphone, I can't do those things, and you just put this thing at my desk, I don't get the rich integration with Exchange, I don't get those things. It's really a
and
bad
becomes,
user experience.
It becomes a separate endpoint, right? So now it has no tethering to your PC, which means you're going to, if you see a call coming on your PC and you click to answer it, it has nothing to do with your phone. You can't transfer between the two from a devices picker perspective. I mean, it's not what you want. So make sure that when if you do the devices, you look at the functionality, the features, and match what it is you're looking for. And keep in mind that CX600s, or the knowledge worker phone levels, whether that be the Astras, the 6725i, and the HP, I don't know that number.
But offhand,
but
I don't
the
even.
HPs, the, whether it be the HP, the Polycom, or the Astra, keep in mind that they can be used as a common area phone too, obviously at a higher cost, and maybe not what you want, but they can be hot desking phones. They can't. They don't have to be a CX500 for those common areas. So it's really your choice. But if you're on the 500, you don't get the functionality of the 600. The 600s can do both. So, okay. So who has enabled what? This is more of the talk about what functionality exists in the 2010, 2013 compatibles versus the optimized. And you'll notice that compatible devices have been kind of scaling and changing more rapidly than the optimized devices. And a lot of that has to do with the capabilities of the vendors to be able to make changes without having to wait for everybody to make the changes. So, in a
Or wait for Microsoft to write
approve.
The code.
Yeah, that's very true, because they own the back end. So compatible devices at the very beginning were limited. They were all narrowband. The quality of audio from peer-to-peer wasn't great. G711 or external PSTN calls, you couldn't tell the difference anyway, but you could tell a difference when you were calling a person internal on a compatible phone versus an optimized phone at the very beginning of this journey. You did not have PIN authentication. That was not available, so they couldn't be used as common area phones. They were really simply Lync contacts. You had LWP. You didn't have Boss Admin, Call Park, 911, all of the functionality you would expect. It was a basic being able to sign into Lync, get presence, make a call. Right?
Pick up, make a call, maybe search the directory, maybe do some basic transfers, but it was pretty feature limited back in the sort of 2010, 2011 arena.
As we got further along, we can see more features were on par and to the original 2010 optimized, missing some things like the full conferencing capabilities, adding and dropping and joining things. They, however, added features like music on hold back on some of these compatible devices, which Lync 2010 did not have and only got here in recent 2013 upgrades of February 2013 cumulative. No?
It came in February. It didn't work till March.
Okay, but it came. The update came, so there you go. We also had Office 365 support's never been in any of these devices till the 2013 models. That's going more on par in what we needed to do. And then you'll notice again that they have some features that have additional features that are not existent or non-existent in the optimized, even in the 2013 world. Some of these things can be multi-protocol stacks. So you could have a phone that could talk to a legacy voice over IP phone system and Lync at the same time. Or the same phone could be used at during a migration or transition. So the user in training was not impacted. 802.1 for authentication has been a big thing for devices because people don't want the ability to just walk up to a phone and use it on their network without it being authenticated. That's still not a supported option on a 2013. As we move towards the Lync hosted pack support, there is no optimized device that works for Lync hosted. You have to use a 3-pip device. So all of these variances started to shift, whereas when we started in 2010 with almost nothing, when we get to the 2013 optimized versus 2013 compatible, we'll see that there is a big shift in more feature sets coming to compatible. And I think that's the exact reason why Microsoft has decided the cadence is too slow in these devices for their development. It needs to be moved to the partners, and that's where we're going. And you will notice these PC pairing, click-to-call, and exchange counter, one-click that are tentative, those are actually already done. That's this pairing over Ethernet capabilities that the new VVXs have built into them with various caveats, and go ahead and research as needed, but that functionality has come its way. And so, wow, you can't use them for Office 365 still. You can expect that that's going to be future coming, and then there is no feature that they do not have that the optimized do. And how they do things are different. The way you interact with the phone is different. The software is different. The management of these phones may be different. But again, it's all evolving very well into a world which you would want to be there. So while all of that's great, then you say, okay, so then why not use a 3-pip phone? What are the gaps? Well, some of the gaps, as mentioned, was the PC tethering, which has recently been kind of fixed by a pairing over Ethernet, which allows your phone to be paired based off the IP of who you want it to be paired to.
Oh, it's a really interesting solution. It's a really interesting solution to this problem. It's pretty powerful, the idea that they can power or that they can pair over USB, or rather
over Ethernet.
Over Ethernet rather than USB simply by knowing a couple of things. It's an interesting proposition.
Yep. The exchange integration gap, again, not so much a gap anymore, and you can log in on these VVX phones with Exchange. What you can do with the information is more limited than what you can do on a Lync optimized phone, but the information is starting to get there. Calendar reminders pop up, whether good or bad, on these phones, and it can ding you. There's a lot of different ways. If you have a phone that was perhaps integrated into some common area that you wanted alerts going off with reminders, I guess you could do it that way. I mean, so there's ways that have come and made it more interesting. Centralized conferencing, the CCP conferencing codecs that are just not there.
How Lync controls a conference.
Right.
CCCP.
And so if you look at how we manage conferences and adds, removes, and invites to these conferences, these phones don't have the capability to do that management of those conferences. And so we're limited in being able to add participants to conferences, injecting people from conferences, building the conference participant list, and then expanding and dynamically as people are coming in. All of that, that's still an optimized. And then Office 365. A 2013 device is going to be required if you want to go to O365.
Right, and when we're talking about O365 here, it's an interesting proposition, right? Because we've said there is no Office 365 support for voice in the cloud, and you need to be enterprise voice enabled to sign into one of these devices. But what that really gets down to is there's a difference between Office 365 multi-tenant that doesn't support that and what is supported in some of the dedicated offerings for O365 that do support that same sign-in.
So, some unique compatible phone scenarios. So, when we're talking about here, what can these phones do? Some vendors, and this isn't on par for all of these three PIP, again, every one and every vendor and every phone device that they offer can be and probably is different. So you'll want to look at that. But dual registration, so that can be, like we were mentioning, where you can have a sidecar and you could have yourself and 15 people actually logged into your one device. And so if a call came in, you could pick up their phone because in reality, you are their phone. You're an endpoint registered for those devices. So if you have these dual, triple, quad, up to 8, 16, whatever the vendors are supporting, your phone is essentially logged in as 16 people or 8 people or 4 people. And so you get their status and can answer calls on their behalf, much like what we would consider a traditional PBX. It's different. You're not going to get the email kind of notifications that somebody picked up your phone because you picked up your phone just on a different endpoint device, right? All right. So the boss admin share line concept, that goes away. We don't have that capabilities yet. It's just not the same experience because you don't have the feedback of what's happening on the boss side.
Right. On the Lync devices in a Lync world, we can do some boss admin scenarios, but it's really about call delegation. In the third-party devices, we're really talking about shared line appearances.
Right. Paging, push-to-talk, they have that ability in that they can have phone-to-phone paging capabilities because they have their own registered endpoint backends. And so outside of Lync, they are talking phone-to-phone.
On those speaker phones, do those capabilities.
They have the capability where people say, I just want to be able to pick up someone's speaker on their desk and start talking to them, whether they want me to or not. Not a capability in the Lync side, not necessarily deemed something they wanted to do, but some people want, and phone vendors can support and do. Again, 802.1 X for that authentication mechanism that you're looking for, a web UI. Whether this is an advantage or a disadvantage, you have the ability to log in and manage these devices through an IP address, whatever IP they get on the network. You have the capability to go to that IP, configure the phone, modify the phone all dynamically, and then custom provisioning. And some of this is integrating directly into the Lync control panel, like the CX or the VVX 500 and 600 series. You'll be able to load up your firmware updates into Lync and allow Lync to push these updates out to the phones, something that has not been capable of any 3PIP device in the past,
yeah,
but it's where
coming.
It's going.
Yep.
Yeah. And so a lot of the headache of any third-party compatible device has been with large deployments. How do I manage them? How do I get firmware updates? How do I set their preferences and settings? More and more of that will be native within the Lync application as the vendors kind of develop their solutions and it becomes more mature. So looking at an optimized versus compatible chart, we see an upgrade today. The Lync server cab is the only way to upgrade your phones.
In an optimized Aries device, yep.
Right, so you put up the cab into Lync and it pushes it out. Compatibles, you have FTP devices that you can tell it to go to a particular IP that's hosting it. You can give manual uploads. You can point to a web URI address, like SNOM does. There are Lync cabs that are coming for some devices that we spoke of. Logs. On the optimized, we uploaded these logs to the device, these ETL logs. Whether you could use them or read them or not was up to you. And support.
That most recent update in CU7 on the devices actually allowed for FTP. Remote FTP.
Right.
You can turn on log upload on those devices and actually FTP directly into the phone and grab the logs for a period of hours.
And which would be like a syslog concept of grabbing, right? And then from a 3-pip, it's the back to the web UI download because where you manage the phones through the web or through a syslog type application. Signing in, tethered or PIN. We're getting to the 3-pip. We're now into the area of PIN. We can use third-party devices. We can use pass authentication devices. It can be something that an application that's custom made that authenticates you in your PC. It really doesn't matter. As long as at the end result is that the device can authenticate through Active Directory to Lync as Lync is expecting. How you authenticate to the phone, we don't know. It's completely abstract from us. And then finally, conferencing. From a compatible phone, you can call into the Lync conference bridge just like a participant could. In an optimized phone, you're actually participating in the conference as a participant that it can manage the conference.
Interact with the roster, drop people from the roster, add people to the roster, those kinds of functionalities.
So some major differences between the two. And you can see the evolution of the compatible phones becoming more and more on par and feature parity with the optimized. And with the announcements that optimized will not be moving forward into any other optimized devices, the future is the compatible devices. That may not mean anything to you today, and for the next 3 years, the optimized may be exactly what you need, but the key point would be to make sure you are looking at other options, other devices that may work, whether you deem them ready for your environment and for your users or not, a solution you're looking for, maybe something in addition to what you have for your current optimized devices. Commonly, paging is one of those things where we need to add that in, so we're going to add that in. But looking at other opportunities and options, that's what you want to look at. So when we look at previous support issues, things that people have spoken about, and perhaps some helpful tips that can kind of come your way, Polycom deployments. So the phone in and of itself, when an end user signs in, the phone must be a Lync profile mode. Centrally managed deployment is another issue that we run into with additional FTP servers and PCLM configs. So one issue that that people are running into when deploying VVX 500 and 600s is they get the device and it's not in Lync mode. Not in Lync mode, then there's no way to sign into Lync. There's a little key sequence that if it's a brand new firmware, it asks you what mode do you want to be in. If not, you've got to go through the menus and get to it. But ensure that you're in Lync mode. And if you go to the web address of the phone, you can also select and change your mode as well. But Lync mode is what changes us from being a SIP address and some number or PIN that logs us in to being a Active Directory user and a password that logs us into the Lync device. Centrally managed is coming again. In the past, has been external FTP servers, an additional one internally to yourself. Setting that configuration internally inside each and every device, that's being mitigated by the ability to push those devices from a Polycom perspective. From a DECT deployment provisioning, the biggest thing that, and this can actually happen to Aries as well, is they get locked on a subnet and they get locked on a VLAN that's been pushed down to them through a provisioning process, whether that's a VLAN tag or whether that's an LLDP med tag that they've gotten. But once they get it, they remember it. So changing VLANs means doing a reset of your device so you can re-pull that information and get the new communication back down to you. But that's an important thing, to, again, especially on these new compatible devices that can be kind of a headache.
Yeah,
you can't figure out why you can't get in.
These interesting little Kirk devices are a pretty interesting system where it's a wireless system running 3-pip software but is signing on over a Wi-Fi signal into a Lync system. And provisioning those is an interesting little challenge.
Yeah, but they do work.
But yeah.
Yeah, but always do a reset. And that's the key for when you're looking at the Kirk devices. And if in doubt, do a reset of the device and see if that resolves your solution. So making sure that, and the same for the SNOM devices, just like on the Kirk devices, make sure, and on the Polycom, make sure you're running the Lync set. On the SNOM devices, there's a Lync-specific firmware that runs the SNOM. Same with on the Kirk. Make sure you're running the ones that are qualified Lync builds for logging into your Lync devices. So SpectraLink, Kirk, these things that were part of Polycom that aren't, and E911, because they were part of this wireless concept, we don't know where you're at. You don't know where you're at any one point. E911 is not supported, I guess, is the point. And so location is messed up. Which could mean if location is not working for 911, that means it's also not working for devices such as location-based routing. So perhaps the specific wireless cordless device, not wireless, but a cordless device would not be a solution that you'd want to invest in if you had these scenarios that mattered and you needed to look at. Presence. When we look at presence, Aries phones replicate Lync phones, right? They take your presence of, you pick up the phone, off it goes, you're in a call. Even if you're not in a call and you pick up a handset and you start to touch the phone, if you were away, now all of a sudden you're available because theoretically you're available on that particular phone device. You may say, no, I am in the other clients, but you are an available phone.
And to some extent, what we're really talking about here is this idea that a third-party interoperable phone probably can't be your only presence on the network, because it needs to have had some other Lync device, be it an Aries phone or a PC, having signed in as the first Lync endpoint for that user to be able to establish presence.
That's right. So compatible phones don't have the same capabilities that the Lync Aries phones had in being a standalone endpoint that had the presence publishing capabilities that are required. And so they don't have the ability to change things dynamically when they first log in because they don't know who they are yet. From a presence publishing perspective. So identities are logged in first on a Lync endpoint. Presence then follows as you would expect on the phone. If you're having presence issues, make sure you're logged in somewhere on a device other than the phone. Log out of the phone, log back into the phone. That more than likely will resolve that issue. So where do you want to find information about these phones? There is the Lync to find more information about IP phones, as well as the differences between optimized compatible, where they're all at. That's all on the UCOIP page. Then there's the little boxes like everything else in the Microsoft world of looking boxes today that you can
tiles.
Click on.
Tiles.
Tiles. Click on tile, figure out where it is you want to go to, and you can go to look at the various devices and what has been deemed compatible. Again, does that mean a device that hasn't gone through the compatibility testing won't work? No. But does it mean it's supported by Microsoft? No, it's not. So if you want something that you know is going to be supported and works without kind of doing this workaround process, then a good way to fix that is to go ahead and look at this website. So with that, we wanted to remind you, if you didn't already know, that there's a Lync conference coming up in February 2014 that's going to be in Las Vegas, Nevada.
Las Vegas!
Yeah, so it's February 18th to 20th, so I believe that
registration's open.
You'll want to go to, I think it's at the Aries Hotel. It should be a lot of fun. Yeah, you can register today at the linkconf.com. Registration is limited and seats are limited, so if you were thinking of going, now's a great time to go ahead and start signing up and get your reservations booked and paid. So with that, we thank you. Have a good one.
Have a good day.